All of you, welcome to our today's webinar. The topic of our today's webinar is the current trend in augmented and virtual reality. As we see that the augmented reality and the virtual reality is really a trending topic in the now's era. So many numbers of research and so many numbers of projects are going on in a topic of augmented reality and virtual reality. So welcome to our today's speaker of our today's webinar, Dr. Ishaq Joel Raj. Sir is a program chair of computer application and assistant professor in the Presidency University, Bangalore. So welcome, sir, to our today's webinar. You can begin with.
Sir, you can start with this webinar.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir. I think it's muted. Can I ask to start it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Definitely.
Okay. Fine. Good morning, all of you. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to present before you this webinar on current trends in augmented and virtual reality. And basically, I'm Ishaq Joel Raj, and I'm the program chair, and I'm heading the computer applications programs here at Presidency University, Bangalore. And my area of research is on multimedia applications, AR, VR, animation, gaming. And today, we are going to talk about one part of that, which is going to be augmented and virtual reality. Why this particular topic seeks attention is that there are a number of chances or possibilities for us to take it forward in terms of research, in terms of academic delivery, and in terms of taking us or preparing us to the next realm, which is the Industry 4.0. Industry 4.0 is a trend which is currently going on wherein we focus on areas of IoT, machine learning, data science, AR, VR, and other things in order to get to the next revolution process in public. So today I'm going to just give you an introduction to augmented and virtual reality, what are going to be the types of devices which you are currently using. Second thing is that what are the areas of research or what are the possibility projects and areas in which you can explore augmented and virtual reality, how to take it forward if you want to take up a career in that, or if you want to take up research activities, initiatives in that, how to take it forward. That is what is going to be the agenda of today. And I have a very concise time of 1 hour, so I need to be quite, I cannot be so elaborate, but wherever there seeks attention, you can always interact and we can discuss further on that. Right. So I think when we talk about augmented reality and virtual reality, we seek to hear many terms. people talk about augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, extended reality, immersive reality, all those things. And now generically we call it together as immersive technologies, right? So what is augmented reality and virtual reality, we'll be talking today, but combining this augmented reality and virtual reality together is generally called as mixed reality, because there was individual components of augmented reality earlier and virtual reality earlier, but there have been situations wherein the combination of both of these was needed and there came mixed reality. And extending it further, you know, using haptics or any other devices, that is called extended reality. And immersive reality is where you have mechanical devices or you have mechatronic based activities which are embedded into the virtual reality component, thereby giving the realistic feel. I think most of us would have realized this or have seen such devices in the malls and other places, where you have a VR headset which is put over your head and you are asked to sit on a plane. The plane automatically moves and it gives you a simulation as though you're riding on a roller coaster or something. That realistic feel, that is called immersive reality, what people are working on. So we'll be taking an overview of what is augmented reality and virtual reality in today's webinar, and how this technology will be taken further in different applications, and how this can be extended further into extended reality and immersive reality. That is going to be there. So generally, we call this together as immersive technology. This process of bringing together these components is necessary, has become more necessary after this pandemic situation. Maybe software-based labs, we were able to do it on a larger extent using online platforms and online web conferencing tools. But hardware-based labs, for example, taking into consideration of a lathe for a mechanical student, or a construction of a building lab for a civil student, or taking into consideration a digital electronics or a microprocessor lab for a electronics student. These labs were badly affected because people were not able to do hands-on or get to know the reality of this particular subjects on a larger scale. So now, though we have something called virtual lab concepts which have been already available, the importance of that particular lab in context of real-time implementation is not there. For example, if a student has to work on this on a lathe, okay, he has a step-by-step procedure which he has been already predefined, but he will not get a real-time feeling as though he is doing in a real-time lab on a physical mode. So this particular reality is what has brought augmented and virtual reality to the next level, because the importance of this particular concept is very evident. And now, henceforth, it's a situation that maybe like we have never been in a situation wherein maybe current students, we have never had been on an online mode on school. Maybe on when you come to colleges and UG and PG programs, we may have experience webinars and other things, or Skype interviews and other things. But nowadays, a small kid, maybe his son is taking his online classes through an online platform called Google Meet. But that is the next level. So imagine the situation, how it is going to be after 10 years maybe. There may be similar situations, or there may be a space wherein the flexibility of education system to adapt to online-based education or hybrid education mode or remote education mode or even at your convenience education mode is going to be more evident. There have been chances that you can do your projects online, everything can be done at your own time and own phase of action. And that could also be possible in the upcoming time. So there, augmented reality and virtual reality is gaining importance. That is one area which people are now focusing on. Second thing is that currently, after the recent government policies and implementation changes, I think our Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, has come up with initiatives where he wants to have more of made in India products or make in India products to be more evident. So recently, there was an event where it is conducted by the Ministry of Higher Education and so on with the other ministries, which is called Talkathon 2020, which was launched. I think most of you would have been aware of that. But this particular event was mostly focused on creating games on physical mode or on digital mode. But one of the most important topic which they were touching it on is augmented reality and virtual reality. in the digital mode, because they wanted to create augmented reality-based games or VR-based games in the market to replace that of foreign games and other applications. But still, the concept of bringing that to the school students and to the college students is now initiated, so that this is going to be again making it more convenient. So we are going to go ahead with different devices. What are the concepts of AR, VR, and how we can cope with different type of applications, and how it has changed the current trends. So what is basically augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, and all these concepts? So imagine a situation wherein you want to simulate a real world which is not really present. Like, we sometimes call it as we become virtual gods, wherein we create something which is not possible to be attained. For example, we have watched movies. We have watched movies on maybe a Jurassic Park kind of movies, wherein we have animated characters, dinosaurs, which are acting around in the characters and moving around. But you being there, standing, giving a feeling that you are standing next to a dinosaur and feeling it, that is itself a bigger picture. So now what happens is that when you're there in the real-time situation, we'll be able to get the real essence of what is happening here, right? And people will be more able to know the seriousness of it. So that is one thing which is there. For example, we have done a recent project wherein we wanted it for a Singapore-based company. And what was the focus on that particular product was that we want, the particular company was investing on so much of money for giving training to their employees for fire safety. So every employee there has to, once he joins the company, has to go through this fire safety and other trainings which were there. And each one, as per the mandate, they have to give practical devices they can give it, or they had to spend more on giving the fire extinguishers and exhausting that. And the process itself was not serving the purpose, because they were like, just, it was like a basic training, and the company wanted to make it more realistic. So now what happens is that unless and until the fire is there in the company, literally, people will not know how to handle the situation. So what was asked is that they had given the blueprint of the company and how the company is there, what are the equipments which are there, all those things, details. And then what they wanted to do is that in case a fire is happening in some place, or even the building is there, so what are the places where they have fire extinguishers placed? Where are the equipments there? How should they handle it? So what happens in this particular process is that the particular employee is given a real-time scenario as though he's going to stand in the same place where he's going to work, is going to be set on fire, and his objective is to put it off. And the concept that was proposed is that how to make it more interesting by making it gamified. So how, for example, if you have just a situation wherein he is going to go, he's like a warrior and he's going to set off the fire, what is he going to do? So with this, what we had given is that two things. One thing is that the information on what are the types of fire extinguishers available. Like, you have different classes of fire extinguishers and what, how do they go about it. Second part is that how do you make it, how do the person react to that situation? Because when you are put into a real-time simulation scenario wherein you feel as though that there's fire around you, that is the time when you get the real sense of the seriousness of it. And when you are using the correct technique and making it out, that training becomes more effective. That is the ultimate process. So instead of just virtually thinking, imagining, we are putting them in the situation wherein they are there in the real-time scenario and we are making them act. So this would solve a large number of casualties if it happens. So that may be a one-time scenario, but if it happens, it is going to be more effective. So this is where we are going to have it, so that the person is going to just put a head-mounted device, and we are going to give him a real-time scenario wherein we are going to simulate the environment for him, and we make him feel as though he's there in the virtual world. Augmented reality, on the other hand, is going to be based on the computer objects which we are going to create it, and we are going to merge the real world with along with the virtual world. That is going to be augmented reality. So for this, we use either mobile phones or a device, other devices which I'll show you. So what happens is that we are going to place imaginary objects onto real world. So now what happens in this process is that even now, if you have seen even Google has come up with AR-based or 3D visualizations of augmented reality based demos. For example, you just type lion in Google and you will be given a 3D view, a 360 view, wherein you can just place it on your table or your real table where your camera gets on, and you can see that the lion is going to be standing on your table or whatever device which you are going to put out. So this has given us the reality. So now people really see what is, for example, if I have to say, this is how lion looks like to a kid showing a picture. Now he could see that how it can walk, how it can react, how it can bounce, all those things, you know, we can get it. So the realistic part of it is that we get to get more details out of it, and people get to, it becomes more interesting. And what happens is that this is how we go. And now what is mixed reality now? So now what happens is that in this process, we are just able to see what is there. And in virtual reality, what was there basically is that how we can go to a different world. Mixed reality is a combination wherein we are able to now interact with objects there. Maybe I can take some objects there and put it out, or I can have a menu option. I can use my eyes and I can turn around and I can feel the different objects. So many other things are now getting up. So now, first part of it is what we are going to see is that the devices which we currently have in the thing. So there are a quick walkthrough of what are the devices or gadgets which you have for VR, AR, and MR, and how do you go about with it. Right. So this section I have put it as headsets, glasses, and devices. So we have different headsets, HMDs we call them, head-mounted devices, or we sometimes have glasses, which we can call we call it as wearables, and we sometimes have haptics also, which I'll show you in the upcoming slides. This is one most commonly used device, HMD, which is called as Oculus Rift. So here, as you can see, this is the entire kit. If you generally get a kit of Oculus Rift, you get this particular kit, out of which the first one is going to be a hand controller. So this particular device, which is there, like a remote kind of thing, it allows us to navigate through objects which are there in the virtual world. Okay, and this particular thing, which is the second one, which is like a mic stand, which is here, this particular thing is the sensor which is going to capture your movements. Basically, we go on with gyroscopic thing based on head movements and the way you move. What happens is that this sensor is able to calibrate and push in your different instances, and it's able to take your movements. Same way, this particular device, which is a joystick kind of thing, which allows you to interact with this. Sometimes you have to go with gaming applications and things. That time, what happens is that this will also be useful. This is one. Or you also have another device which is called as HTC Vive, which is mostly again a device. So you have two hand controllers given here, so you can customize both your right hand movements and left hand movements. Most of our projects we have done with HTC Vive. So what happened is that we have two sensors which are placed in the diagonal corners of the room. And first thing what we do is that we first calibrate the room. So the HTC Vive provides us with a software application which allows us to make the properties. That you see, it just scans through the room, and what happens is that we will be able to get the boundaries of the room, because there is a chance that when you are wearing the headphones and device, what happens is that you will not be able to know what is there around you. It's like a blind man having a cuff around his eyes, right? What happens is that we need to know that we are not crossing a particular level of proximity, so that we may not fall down. So what happens is that the room has to be calibrated first, and we should ensure that the leveling of this particular devices are perfect. So once you start this, you can wear this head-mounted devices and we'll be able to navigate it. So this HTC Vive and Oculus Rift are the most common or professionally used ones which are currently used. So how does this really act? Basically, is that this device has a number of lenses, it has a housing, you have a liquid crystal LCD displays which are there, and driver control. So what happens basically is that either it allows you to zoom in and zoom out, and also allows you to space the visuals. So the spacer is something which allows you to give crystal clear vision. So this controls will be there available in your HMD itself, so that you feel more comfortable on it and we can move ahead. Right, and now other devices have also come. Maybe these are the devices which are quite cheap in stature. This particular devices do have an internal control. So for example, you have an internal display which comes with the HTC Vive and other devices where you can visualize the things which you see there. But in Samsung Gear and other devices like this, this is another type of HMDs wherein you take up your mobile phone and that has to be spaced into this particular devices and that becomes your virtual display. So this sort of devices are quite cheap in station, maybe equated around in Amazon for around 1,500 to 2,000 rupees or even 5 before you get a decent device. But what happens in this particular thing is that sometimes, you know, you have the display very close to your eye. And the second thing is that sometimes, you know, if it's not properly configured, people do have do get headaches and migraines because the spacing and magnetometer is not that perfect sometimes. So it is, if you're getting this for that, Samsung Gear VR was some device which was giving decent output when compared to conventional other cheap quality devices. And so and it has become again an industry standard. So now we are able to get or visualize objects which are there in virtual world through these devices. Next thing is that this is Google Cardboard, which is a similar kind of device, a very innovative product which has been brought by Google. So Google product, this Google Cardboard concept, which is like a DIY kind of device. So what you need is basically some lenses and you have a printout which you can take it or a cardboard which you can, I think it's still available there in Amazon and other places where you can order a DIY kit for around 200 or 300 rupees, this is the entire thing. So you get a sheet wherein you can, it's like a DIY kind of thing, so you can take up this particular cardboard cuttings and engravings and you can make this device, you can customize it, you can paint it. And what you can do is that we have to just keep a mobile phone in this particular device and it has lenses which are placed, so that will give you that difference of view and we can able to, we'll be able to see the objects in virtual reality or virtual world. But these devices were quite popular, but Google again had an improvisation to that. The second version what had was magnets which are had. So magnetometer is something which can, which will be able to give you that realistic movement of this particular device. So now you can, you need these magnets in addition to the existing lenses which improve the quality and efficiency of this particular device. So this one device is almost, you know, more, if you can see foreign universities and other things, they will have the initial stages, you know, when courses are launched. They ask people to make their own Google Cardboard so that they can review their devices and they hands-on know what is there inside the basic layout of a VR device. So this is something very cheap and effective. And other things which are very popular are these VR1 and this VR1 IGX, this is there. And Stone has come up with this PS4, which is a VR-based gaming station, which again, is something which is very popular in the market. Because what happens is that this particular device has provided opportunities for gamers, hardcore gamers to go into immersive gaming mode. So you just wear the device, you have the joysticks and handheld controllers which are given to you. So what happens is that we are able to play games which are realistic. So this is again one device which are possible. For academic usages and other things, HTC Vive and Oculus is more commonly used for gaming. Sony PS4 with this VR is quite very popular. And for cheap viewing, or for example, if you want to have a decent movie, which is you want to watch it on 3D or Vision, then you can go for Samsung VR is again quite a standard device. People are now using it. And Google Cardboard always is a plaything kind of thing, which is very, very innovative, very attractive, because what happens is that it's like you make your own way. Okay, so you design that particular cardboard, you attach components to it, you paint it, and you can customize it. We have seen people painting crazy artwork, so many things they do that so that they can have their own devices for viewing and taking up the projects. Now, one problem with these devices, since this type of devices which you attach your mobile phone, another thing is that the content has to be first loaded into this particular device and then you have to watch it. This is just for preview purpose. We will not be able to control the devices. But in this HTC Vive and Oculus Rift and other kind of devices, you have this handheld controllers. So you have real-time navigation and interaction to this, same with Sony PS4 also, the same concepts applies. With input devices and we will be able to interact with the system, we'll be able to control the objects onto the plane, and with that we'll be able to get a realistic feel. The next thing is called smart glasses. We have come to a situation wherein reality and virtual reality had to be put together. So what happened is that people started wanted to know with how to go about with this. So they wanted to bring with HMDs, which were a combination. Now we have Google glasses. For example, this is a conventional kind of glass, but this glass has a projector or a projection which is here in the leftmost on the right eye part of it. So this particular device has will be able to provide us with merging of real world with immersive world. So what happens is that you have real-time visuals which you can see through the glass, and you'll also be able to see imaginary characters or visual components which could be added up to this particular thing. So what happens is that I'll be able to do this, and even research work on how to add interactivity just by using your eye movements, for example, through blinking or through gazing or through double blinks, or how we are going to interact with it. That is also an area of, again, current research. So you have so many smart glasses which have come up. The brands which are very popular are given there. You have Epson's Movario, which is very popular. BT200 is very popular. And now you have BT250 and 300 latest models. They have upgraded it also. Google Glass is one. Sony Personal 3D Viewer is also there. There are so many models, and every model I think I have put up there. But what happens in this particular approach is that in India especially, Epson Movario was launched, and we had Lumus which was launched, and Sony HMZ which was launched. But still, Epson Movario was more popular, but availability of such devices or the usage statistics of such devices is not more prominent yet. Many people do not still prefer buying Epson Movario or devices which are for AR and integrated media. So, because the pricing is costly, first thing. Second thing is that the usage applications are still not there. Because if you have more number of applications which have been developed on this, the usage statistics will be high. Not necessary, maybe after 10 years or 15 years, maybe smart glasses would be the need of the hour, wherein because we'll be dealing with real-time applications involving AR, VR, and Industry 4.0. That is a long way to go, but still, working on that domain provides a lot of scope. Right, so Google Glass, this is the website which they have. I think I put up things. So what happens is that they have so many models which you can do. They customize it, so they put it more interactive. So what happens is that we can choose what is the style of template, how to navigate it, what is the design pattern. All these things can be there. So if you can see this, I have a link which is put up there, which is developers.google.com. /glass. I'll be sharing this PPT with your coordinators, so that if you want, you can have a look at this link. Next thing is that this is again another smart glass kind of thing. So I just wanted to give you, I have given some difference of information which is there. So all of this to serve the same purpose, but they have navigation, they have voice control, so many other things which have been put up in this APX and they can't. Right? Same way, Optiment smart glasses. So this will be mostly from henceforth will be going through this particular type of wearables. So what happens is that one simple application of this, I'll say, maybe I have a person who has to be trained in a particular machine, or if I have to go with a fire safety training to a particular device. So what I can do is that I can tag individual places. I'll be showing you the applications part when I come to that. So there, what happens is that each part of that can be applied. So now I can have a guided walkthrough. For example, earlier, there, if you are taking people, I think most of us are from computer science background. So when you take people to digital electronics, a microcontroller lab, for example, I'll say. So we deal with either Arduino or Raspberry Pi. Okay. So now that a faculty has to be there on screen or in the front, and he has to give them individual instructions. Right, and the student has to get that instruction and he has to do it. Right, there are chances that he may have doubts or he may want a step-by-step tutoring process. Now, wearing glass like this, AR-based glass like this, now the student will know what is each part of that. Maybe like he's having a connector there. He'll be having a caption which says that this is the controller or this is the power supply unit. So this is where you can connect this. So it helps him to do a step-by-step procedure. So what makes it more convenient for him is that he will not tend to get mistakes and he will have a guided learning process. So, and this is again kinet-based devices, which is brought out by Microsoft, which came up with these devices. Okay, this is called Kinect 360. So these devices are more popular with AR-based gaming or VR-based gaming. So what basically it has is that stereoscopic camera, which you have, and a sensor. Right? If you can see this, there's a sensor which is going to be there. There are two cameras which can track you. So what this particular device do is that it provides you with gesture-based solution or markerless motion capture. So it captures your motion, and we'll be able to interact with it. For example, I would like to say some real-time cases which people have taken up on this device. For example, if you want to have a leader who is no more with us. For example, you want to recreate, or you want to do something like you want to shoot a movie which is there in 360 or a virtual world wherein Mahatma Gandhiji has to come live. Right? So now what is the process we do there is that we use such Kinect devices. We ask a person who could recreate or react like Gandhiji. Okay, so a person who is of the same height, same stature almost, and who could perform his body actions is called. And what happens is that we create a model of this person, of Gandhiji in 3D, using a 3D software. And what we do is that we make the person who is going to act like Gandhiji on screen in front of the Skynet, and we are going to make him move. So what this process does is that it forms a virtual skeleton, and we move these people on this virtual scenario. So now what happens is that whenever this person moves on the virtual world, that is going to affect the animation of the model which we have created. And that is how most of the realistic motion capture and 3D visuals are coming. Earlier there was a technology wherein we had to wear motion capture suits and other things. See, we are doing that because they have their own advantages. But replacing that with markerless or with devices which do not have any suits or gadgets to be put out is brought out by this Kinect. And currently, if you have to see about this Kinect technologies, we have games, so many games which are applied. And I think I've seen a couple of places wherein they have this devices kept for public access. For example, in movie theaters and malls, they do have this tennis game kind of thing wherein you just move your hand, flip through your hand, and you play the game. So this creates a realistic experience. And one more thing is that we are currently moving the instance from the person being idle on a game device sitting, instead of that we are giving him a real-time activity. So earlier if he has to play cricket, he can sit and play cricket or a football here. But now we are coming to a technology wherein we are making him stand, we are making him play on a real-time indoor environment, simulating the world. So which provides us with so much scope. And this is one device which is a very important device which is currently there, which is again brought by Microsoft, which is called the HoloLens. This particular device is a professionally used product for industrial development, research, and I think quite costly, but it has so much of features which have been put up. It's a very standard product which has mixed reality components. First thing is that it has projectors. It has a screen where you have projectors where you can see your visuals. Second thing is that you have a microphone, so you can have real-time navigation. You have a camera in front, so you can capture a similar world, and you have the sensors, depth sensors, which can capture the distance between the proximity between the source and by objects. Now, what happens here is that we have a mechanism where we'll be able to interact with real-time objects and navigate through objects onto the real world. So this is conventionally a prop. So if you can see here, this is an interaction device. I told you this is a solution which I have been developed based on real-time interaction. So here, if you can see here, this is where your Kinect is connected to a camera, to a television there. And based on the movements of how the person is going to interact, we can have a control over objects which are there on the display. So just moving and flipping through the hands, you'll be able to control various aspects of the television. And see this is again application wherein we are controlling the real-time objects using Kinect and other things. You will be able to kind of take control through your web pages. You can watch videos, you can flip through it, you can play fast forward. Anything can be done, or even you can have a dial pad which is virtual without not even having something which is on screen, right? And I was talking about this Kinect-based direction. So if you can see here, we have different types of tracking now. And this particular tracking with this one device, Kinect devices, there have been so much of devices, because this is one, this smaller device, which is around 10,000 rupees. With this one particular Kinect sensor, we are able to do different types of things. We can have marker-based tracking or markerless tracking. Marker-based is like you have sensors over your body or reflectors over your body, and you'll be able to track that. Markerless tracking is just like that. You go in front of the camera and the system is able to capture your shape, your height, all this. Like, it's able to this visually track you. And other thing is the 3D object tracking, face tracking, environment. This provides us a lot of scope wherein we are going to capture the objects in 3D. And this has provided us object opportunities for 3D object tracking, 3D visualizations, and so much of applications of image processing and data science could also be taken forward from this. Same way, identification of images and other transcripts are also possible, right? So when you talk about this particular technologies, people are using it in different industries, including animation industry, or you talk about image processing or video processing applications. You can do a lot with this, right? Currently we are working on a project wherein the target is very simple. The task is that we have wanted to have a number page detection system, though it may sound very feeble or a very normal one, which is currently there. The problem was very unique. This is basically something, a project which is also from the United States. And what happens is that every number plate in every state there in the United States is different. And you have so many, you are allowed to write whatever information you want to put out. For example, I can put a name, I can put some graphic, I can put any thing which you want on a number plate. So now what happens is that every number plate is unique, every number plate is different. And what happens is that there was a problem which was stated is that people were not able to find the exact number plate, because what happens is it has so much information. Getting the exact number alone was one challenge. Second thing is that maybe in trucks and other places, they do have the credibility to write whatever they want. So some people write or have stickers on their cars and vehicles. So identifying the exact number plate was a difficulty. And the other thing was the different climatic conditions which were evident. So how to tackle this? So when the conventional CCTV cameras and other things are there, they're going to be singular monochromatic cameras. But current devices like this are going to be 3D, and these devices are going to get more realistic and more attractive. So this particular devices have provided us this opportunities for taking the research to the next level. So this is called marker based. Okay. Next, this is again a new system wherein cave automatic virtual environment. What is this cave-based VR solutions? So this cave-based VR solutions is the next one which has been come up, wherein instead of using something which is called as just simulating a real world, we are now using a 360 view of this particular environment. Earlier we were wearing HMDs, which are head-mounted devices. That was one thing. But the second thing which we went was like we wanted to have, the issues were that we wanted to have a head mounted device on our head. So prolonged usages were quite uncomfortable. That is one problem. Second thing is that for each person, I have to give a head mounted device. If I want to have a group of people, it is not possible. But here, if in cave based systems, okay, what we have is that we have multiple projectors which are surrounded. Maybe you have two projectors or three projectors which are surrounded us. And we create a 360 world around you based on the projections which are made there. So for this purpose, you have a dedicated concealed environment where you have projectors, and this projectors project whatever is the virtual environment. So without using a head-mounted device or using a partial head-mounted device, we'll be able to have a virtual world around us, and we'll be able to interact with it. This is the first advantage. Second thing is that you can have audio components, because we have a thing, we can have audio tracking sensors on the walls. We can have distance sensors. So many other applications are there. So this is particularly something which is very popular nowadays, and people are able to give it. And one such application, why I wanted to put this particular application, is that this is something which has been used in training the pilots and skydivers. There is a video which I, if I don't have time, I could show you, wherein in cases of emergency, if a parachute has to be deployed, and how to use it. So what happens is that you cannot make a person teach the same thing, taking him to the sky, making him jump. But that could be possible in a cave-based system, because what happens is that you can have a suspended sensor, wherein you can hang the person like a real-world scenario, and you can have a HMD kind of environment wherein you create a virtual world, so that he will enact as though he's jumping from that, or you can give him the motions of how it would look when he is jumping from a height, and that could make all the difference. So that provides us with a lot of opportunities for real-time interaction on a virtual world and things. So it's like a cabin kind of space where you have a wall and you have projection floors, speakers, and you have tracking sensors to take you out to the next level. And these are the devices which are called the data gloves, which are coming up. There are so many companies which are coming up, so many research which are there. One particular problem which we have is that we will not be able to do interactivity on a real time using a hand controller. It's like you have a device in hand, you can control the objects on screen, but how to take different things there, or how to, it's like touching it or playing with it. So for that, we are coming up, the people have come up with devices which are called the data gloves. So now what has happened with this is that we are able to do, based on the hand movements, people are able to do changes in the system. For example, if you have to do an action for moving to the next channel on a television, I can just have like devices like this, wherein I can just have a flip of my hand, I'll be able to go to the next channel. I can do so much of things. I can interact with the objects, I can take objects. So based on your actions, we'll be able to do interactivity. Now, most of the research work is going on with bringing in devices which could add haptics to the existing environment. So recently I was talking with a company which was there, which is an Indian-based manufacturer. So these people are now coming up with a device which could be like a AR-based and VR-based device together on a single head. So you just have a flip, or you have a panel which you can put it on your friend. Right. Once you see through, once you put that flap, it becomes a VR device. Once you remove that, you have a glass. So now it becomes an AR device. And now what they're working on is that how to have a head-mounted gloves, or data gloves, which could be added. So their concept is just have a wristwatch kind of thing, or a smart band kind of device, which would track your movements of your fingers, and based on that, how to provide with haptics. So this is again coming up. This is again a thing. And obviously, as you know, this is a data suit, or we call it as a motion capture suit, mock-up suit, we call also call it. So this particular device has so many sensors around the body, and putting a head-mounted device along with it, now you have so many sensors in the suit, so that we'll be able to have 360 or view through this HMD. And second thing is that this devices, which is a suit, will have vibrators, it has sensors, so what happens is that you'll be able to do whatever we are taking and putting out objects on screen. That is possible. Second thing which is also possible in this device is that providing with realistic feedbacks. For example, if I want to have a game kind of environment wherein I want to have a shooting game, if a bullet is on your body, then it gives you a vibration, you may feel the realistic part of it. So that is how people are coming out with this. Now, these are the devices which are conventionally available, right? So now, how is it going to apply in current industry and other things? So though it has come, this concept has VR has come up in 1950s, much of that particular thing came up in only 1990s. People started working on games and entered into the gaming market. But what is this particular thing is that creating a virtual world on the real-time scenario. So you have a head-mounted device, you have audio which is given to you as an input so that you can feel the realistic audio. Right, so now what happens is that we give them a realistic presence and feel. So most of the times when you have VR devices, maybe like people who are working on in this particular world, we have experience with different kind of devices. For example, we have if you have a VR device, you'll be able to travel around the world without even really existing going through the places. Maybe most of the important tourist spots and other things have been captured using 360 view, and with a HMD device, not necessarily a costly device, just a normal device, you'll be able to walk through or three different kind of places on real time. That is also possible. Or if you are going through the next cell, we can have interactivity, we can play games and other things, wherein we have virtual presence and other things. So this has different multitudes of uses for education and entertainment industry, and for different applications we have different cases. So I'll have a quick walkthrough because I think I have a number of slides to go, but still just now I'm getting to virtual reality. So earlier there was a time wherein we had to visit places, but now you can create field trips taking you to the places or spaces or different environments. Spaces, why you're given two spaces is that, first thing is that one is literally spaces like work environment kind of thing, and the other one is virtual space or the galaxy. So that kind of trips can be possible. You can have a thing. And this particular device is when you want to develop something like this, it can be, if it's along with mechatronics, mechanical plus electronics, like you have a device which could give you a seat kind of environment where we can have the movements we felt on our human body, that would create products. Right, and immersive training in terms of military applications, wherein you have combat training for the military people, or usage of different weapons, or usage of deploying the bombs, and even DRDO is working on how to launch this radars and other things, and missiles, how to launch it during emergencies, how to calibrate it. All the trainings are being given on a multi immersive environment. Or you can even have started with a simple application like driving, making an online simulator wherein the person has to avoid different tap holes, or even storytelling, gaming, giving therapy. I'll give you a video about how therapy, a small video of how autism-based patients are treated on using VR-based gadgets and environment, and marketing applications. So maybe like a number of companies we have done, a student has done this project. What happens is that he has made a 360 walkthrough of a particular house or the apartment complex. So what happens is that this particular company is like a real estater who has come up with this concept. He wanted this and it has been done for him. So he gave a footprint of how this house would look like. And instead of investing on demo house, generally, you know, you go with large flats and apartment kind of environment. What they do is that they have a house which is called a demo house or a sample house, wherein they create the interiors, they create sofas and other things, and they show you how the house would look like after you fill in with things. This is what they show with the people who wanted to visit their property and give it. So instead of investing on such devices and other things, this person came up with this plan called Ching. This is right before the two, three years back. And one of the advantages is that they did not take, they had number of things which were in focus. Though it sounds quite costly, he just had one device, which is a HTC Vive device, which was purchased for his office and a particular system. And what happens is that the people who are coming there to visit this, they'll be asked to wear this head mounted device, and they can customize their house. For example, he gave an option that they have 10 different models of sofas. So he had given them different view suggestions of how this interiors could be made. So people were really able to see how the house would look like after it was put up. And other things is like the walkthrough. So for moving from one room to another room, people had to just look at a particular gaze at a particular spot on the particular video. So they'll be able to go to the next room. So they will be able to travel also through different applications being in the same place. So So he had, this was creating interest in the people, first thing. Second thing is that it was like giving them a realistic view of how different solutions, instead of being one demo house, you can now make 10 demos of how the house could be made, especially for interior people. So then the third thing is that they had to travel people, because it was there in Chennai, from Chennai, traveling through different power, taking people to the different flats was becoming a difficulty. Now people come here to one menu, and what happens is that they'll be able to view through different properties. For example, if a real estate has four different apartment complexes in four different areas and he wants to show it, clearly they have to take them to different places. Now at the being at the same place, he'll be able to, they will be able to view it on a real time or before even it is there. So marketing has so many applications in this. So now people are coming up with desktop-based VR applications using conventional devices like keyboard, mouse, along with that. That is not actually fully VR, but desktop VR we call it. And immersive VR is where you have this HMDs and gloves and thing, body suits. And even sometimes people now are using trampolines where they can have that vibrating and other kind of things. And you also have VR mixed VR devices. So business-based applications, you have 360 videos which are there. As I told you, we create a 360 walkthrough of the entire flat complexes or buildings or even to this part and other things. That is there. Training is again an area which people are now, proposals can be dropped in because there are so many options for this. And one more thing which we had brought out with here is that this training process is that we created one project was developed by a student where this happened coincidentally. One thing is that the person, one fellow wanted to create a VR-based car driving game. So what he did is that he using hand controllers, he was able to do it. Another student, he was interested in IoT-based kind of devices and other things, sensors and other things, so electronics. So both these fellows then joined together. What they did is that they took a steering of a old Maruti 8 engine, and they created the constraint like how a steering could be rotated. And they integrated this VR with this particular device as the input. So now what happened is that they were able to create a partial real-time simulator wherein the Maruti 8 engine steering could be controlled, and that could be creating a simulation of how car driving. So people can start going ahead. With that, they stopped it. But the initial plans were that if they were able to provide the steering, accelerator, brake, and clutch kind of environment and a gearing system, I think it became a virtual simulator at a cheaper cost. Same way, engineering design, earlier there were like cars which are manufactured, tested and other things. Now building construction, designing, all those things, when you're able to put them in 3D and visualize that, it is more innovative. And same way, currently now people are now working on with 3D softwares like Maya or 3ds Max and other things. Embedding that with virtual devices like this, wherein we can have 3D views. So you'll be looking at the object car, you know, when you're designing a car in 3D, you'll be able to see how the car would really look like in, when it's constructed. Same way, medical applications. Now doctors have come up with this particular training process wherein when you go with devices like this, for example, you want to do a very big operation and things like that, people are able to do VR-based trainings. That is possible. You can keep develop gadgets for that. And especially for, you know, for when devices like you go with dentistry or nursing for nurses, and different for each of the categories of people who are there, surgeons and things, they are able to get the first-hand training on through devices. So medical industry has so many applications and they are wide acceptance because you have complex surgeries which are possible, which can be trained, people can, more doctors can be trained, and they would be more prevalent on other, how the situations would look like. And you can have tests with different varieties of conditions wherein if this is happening, what would you do? For example, if there's a bleeding, the patient is there operated, what should be done? So that type of trainings can also be given, that is possible. In addition to the conventional kind of things, museums, games, virtual theme parks, all those things, the entertainment mediums, you have so many market, a big market there. Even in this Toycathon, which I had told you, virtual museums is one particular concept which our students have proposed there in this particular competition, wherein they can have interactivity, taking into considerations of different things. So they're working on there. Not necessarily that very big people. They're first year students, they're working on this such kind of environment, because what happens is the technology has more to explore, and how, what is the level of complexity you bring into that, what is the level of sophistication you bring to that, and what is the level of immersiveness you give to that, that makes all the difference, right? So there are some disadvantages currently we are facing the VR. First thing is that social isolation. You are just you wear a head-on HMD and you stay from the real. You always really stand in the virtual world. There have been cases of depression, which is possible. Psychologically, one thing is that we are our brain gets confused, which is the real world, which is the imaginary world, and all those things. And prolonged usage of the headphones, hearing problems, and eyes, because the display is very close to this. Sometimes we tend to have eye irritation and other things. So what is advised is that after each 10 minutes of usage, we are supposed to remove the glasses. But real time, when you're doing your projects and other things, most of the times it takes even a longer time. So this is one thing. But one advantage of this particular thing is that taking this is not, it's easier. Like you create something, you know, when you're coding and doing some projects, we get a feel that we are just running the codes and getting the required output. But here we are creating something, so it becomes more interesting. At the same time, it is more technical also, and we have more of such applications to go ahead. Right. So now I have a small video, which is just a 2 minutes video, wherein we have autism patients who have been given here. This is a training which has to be given to them, because what happens with autism patients is that they have to be trained to different environments, and they are they always tend to seek away from people, right? So what happens is that this is a training which is given to them so that they can focus on what will be the different kind of situations they would face in a mall. So this is just a video. I'll just play through the video so that you can have how this experience is created.
I'm autistic, and I just get too much information.
Okay, so what you could see here was an ideal case wherein a person with autism is made to experience this VR kind of treatment, wherein he will be able to see all the possible viabilities which you could see or experience in a mall. So while taking these patients, they tend to be isolated from this. When they are taken to a crowded place, they tend to feel quite nervous, distracted, and they develop a sense of fear, which generally creates disturbance to them. So now, what was this particular training is that taking a real-time experience of a VR-based experience of a mall, the person will be able to see through different situations, and what you could see that eye was the eye blinking of that particular thing, how he was reacting to this particular thing. Taking through again and again through virtual reality experience of the same mall, okay, now what happens is that he is now interacting with people there. So you can see that there's housekeeping people who can clean that. There were people who could do different things. All these things was possible. You talk about people who are coming with balloons. You had people who are like general public who come and gaze at you or just stare at you and pass by. All those things, environments were there. So this gives them a confidence to them, and they'll be able to, when they go to the mall real time, they'll not be able to see much of difference because they are interacting with people, right? So now coming to this, which is called this augmented reality, right? So we are using the handheld devices which we conventionally have, and we are going to put up different objects, or we can visualize different things. For example, now visual dresses, visual applications on AR have come up. For example, you have to choose a dress, and you can have a VR on. Like you can ask somebody to catch your phone, or you can have a selfie mode. You can just preview how this particular dress would look on you. That is possible, right? Or you can have without purchasing it, like I told you, see this, we have some furnitures which have been placed there in the room, which do not exist. So you will know how does that particular furniture would fit your space. Or now even paint companies have come up with this particular application wherein you have the walls painted according to your choices. So you have your real-time wall taken. You can just take your phone and focus on your wall, and you can paint it with different colors. You can check how the house would look like after you have painted it before, so that it will help you to paint it. So the thinking process has been demanded, or have been evaluated. It has been improving on that particular realm. So without even having a device like this or having an object which is there, now you can bring it onto screen. So you can see that all this have been matching over with the current space which is there. So that is how we are going again. So adding a component to the real world is called augmented reality. So bringing this all, this is where the demarcation have brought it. First thing is that you have VR-based devices. You have this Oculus Rift. You have Samsung VR and other HMDs. Then you have this AR-based pro devices, which is called Google Glass, Epson Mavario, as I told you, and other things. The combination of this together is going to be called as augmented reality, or augmented virtual reality, or you call it as mixed reality. So this particular thing has taken up a long way to go. So we are using this. One advantage of this is that for this, you don't need to have any specific devices. Just your handheld devices would solve the purpose. You can have a tab, or you can have a mobile phone, whatever is there, you can have it. So now, this is an example wherein research, wherein people are now combining real world with computer generated data. So what happens is that this is actually interview by Google is trying out with this, wherein once you pass through or drive through it, you will get information about whatever the places which you have in this. Or there have been cases wherein AR-based navigation systems. For example, now the current problem which we have is that you get a map. You go to a particular location, right? Then but what happens is that you will not be able to know which building is there or where the person is, right? So for example, he is there, is he there to the left side of the road or to the right side of the road? So that is again a problem. So Google is now coming up with a navigation-based interactive AR-based application wherein you have a fox which will guide you through that. So it will jump through the right and it will show you that this is the house. So you can travel through that and you can reach your places. This is again an application. And haptics can be also embedded into AR-based systems, so that when you move it and other things, that could be also added up to the existing AR material. That is possible. So now we have different types of AR applications which we have there. One is that we use QR codes or we use cameras, and that is called marker-based AR. I think most of us, we use QR code and for our day-to-day digital transactions. That is a simple kind of a marker-based AR. So AR is already there in day-to-day life. But there have been also situations wherein the images have can be captured and they can be processed and taken to a markerless AI. And this uses GPS and digital compass technologies. That is also possible. And we also have projection-based AR, wherein we project, we call it holographic projections, wherein we project imaginary objects onto virtual world. I think you can see some kind of this in malls and museums also nowadays, wherein you can create, have virtual objects projected and you create a 360 or a 3D view of that particular thing. That is possible. Then superposition-based AR, wherein you is like the walkthrough kind of thing, or the how bringing in imaginary characters through the mobile devices. So these are the different types of ARs which we are currently working on. So AR is just a generic term, but we can do a lot with this. Same way, we have a virtual furniture app or a dressing room or research app, as I told you. These are all the examples. Pushing through because of lack of time. So first thing is that the camera has to be set. You have to customize the camera so that it will be able to identify the plane. Then you are supposed to register the information of that room. Then you will be bringing in virtual objects to the display. This is the concept. First you take the camera, or first your camera has to start. Then you have to register the place. Based on that, you can have the footages interpreted on that particular thing. So I think Pokemon Go is one game which has made a very big impact, even in India, wherein people were hunting for characters there and traveling based on the GPS-based navigation games. And there are other alternatives which happened here. But this game is one very popular because it was the only first of the kind game which had movement of the people. People were running to different places, taking bikes, running through and catching this Pikachus and other things. So that is something which was the next phase. Same way, military-based applications wherein you take through the Google Maps or any other sources, you get the map locations, you find activities there, you're able to give them realistic field trainings and other things. That is also possible, right? Same way, medical usages, based on it, you will be able to know, guided through tools, or this particular devices can scan through the objects and it can be able to analyze it and give you a real-time scenario explaining what is there, how it is there, and other things. Same way, you have navigation-based applications wherein you can be able to devise on what is the category of location we are going to do. Sightseeing, so when you are going to focus on a place, it will be able to, or even it can be used in museums. When you focus on a particular location, it is going to give you what is the details of that thing. So not necessary that you need to do. An AR-based application like this could be implemented on any place, and that could solve most of your things. Maintenance and repair, for example, even a person who wants to learn mechanic-based applications, fitting out with objects and things like that, he can do this. So he'll have a glass which is put, so he'll say first attach this, first remove this, how to remove a battery. That could be a simple lesson which can be taught to a person with just AR-based application. Next thing is that marker-based ARs are also possible, wherein you have you ask the person to take his mobile phone and focus on a particular book. Okay, each part, for example, you have a small book ABCD for a LKG person or an LKG student. You can bring a real-time Apple. When you have focused the camera onto a interface, it can give you a virtual walkthrough. So these particular things have now very popular. One thing is that you have this 360 view of the cars and other things, you know, on a virtual world also they are now giving it, and AR also they are giving it, where you can take your phone, you can scan through the newspaper ads, they'll be giving you a 360 view. Even some jewelers, I think GRT Jewelers, which is one of a popular brand in India, they have a AR-based calendar. They have given a calendar, and when you scan through the link which is given in the calendar, you'll be able to see the 360 view of it, right? And so you have marker-based, wherein people will be protected with, when they are able to see the particular marker, you will be able to identify it. So you'll be able to see people, distance, everything. So, and here you see an example wherein just a QR code is put up there and people are asked to scan. So based on this, when you scan it, people will be able to see the AR experience of it. They'll be given, you can take it, you can play videos, you can play animations, you can play something, information which is still being given to them. So that is the next drill. So now, when people start out, you know, for example, if you want to have an event brochure, earlier we used to have posters and other things displayed on it. Now you have a QR code or a device like this. People are able to scan it. They get the videos or information out of it. So that is the next reality or the concepts which we are working on. Same way, this is augmented reality, wherein you can see that how people could be fitted into a space and how different tables, the table doesn't exist on a real time, but how does it up to different situations you can put out there. Same way, marketless tracking again is very famous because you have here just a camera and a display which has been put up on a fixed spot. And you can just take your devices, you'd be able to, for example, this happens in every toy shop. When you are going to take a box or a toy, you will not be allowed to open it unless and until you pay for it. But here, now this AR-based thing allows us to see what is there inside or the details of it. For example, you go to a Reliance Smart for buying headphone, you will not be allowed to break it. But now, what is inside there, what are the contents of it, all these things are possible. Same way, location-based tracking, travel guides, slam books, visualizing this, games, okay, tattoos. This is again, I see this. This is one simple application which is there. There, wherein you can have, you can put up different tattoos on your skin and you can check it out. Same way, you can have different stars, different deployments. You can check with different options. So many things are possible. All right, and this has given us the next level. So now we are in a situation wherein we are using AR and VR based devices that create the productivity. Second thing is that create the next level of content. Right, but what happens is that there are very few future spam, because I can give anybody a QR code and ask them to scan it. It may have some problems, but still the problems are very limited. But this field has a long way to go, and it has a lot of potential in which we can go ahead in this particular realm, right? Okay, sorry for the orientation. Okay, so what languages we are currently using it? With this, I'm going to stop it. Unreal Engine 4, Blender, WebVR Content, Unity 3D. So these are the common places where we code for VR and AR. Unreal Engine 4 and Unity 3D are almost free tools, free game engines, wherein I think maybe if you are aware, your PUBG game was developed in Unreal Engine, right? And you also have Java 3D application, wherein some people do some part of coding. Blender is a 3D animation tool, wherein you can create 3D assets. It's an open source tool, and you can go ahead. And WebVR Content is something wherein we can have virtual reality gadgets added on a real time. Softwares for VR, as I told you, this Unreal 4, all this I put up into this list. But in addition to that, you have OpenGL, Lumberyard, Iris VR, Cubicle, VR Space. There are so many applications which have now come up. Even ERXR is one tool for education people, which is very popular, but it is quite pricey. But wherein you can just import 3D models and you can start creating your own video materials for VR and AR based 3D videos. So many other things. So Unreal Engine uses C++ as this, and what happens is that you can have visual effects, you can have advanced film processing, artificial intelligence based other things. Unity is again a suitable competitor, which is very popular. Unity is actually doing very great in terms of AR and VR, because you have more features and assets which can be added to this. You can have games, you have 360 videos, you can have real-time interactions. So this is two tools which you can start exploring if you want to get into this. Same way, the other alternative is to that is going to be Lumberyard, which is providing similar features to this. But what happens is that you have real-time gameplay editing, which is a part of unique part of this particular software. Right now, apart from this, you have AR Toolkit, you have A-Frame and other things you can bring it. Okay, so now head-mounted displays, you can contact, you have different types of lenses. First thing is that you have to buy a head-mounted display or an eyeglass, any one of this to start out with this. Not necessary, it has to be so costly, it can be cheap also. It can be easy to access also. It can be just you have to start off with a glass. And now, research on this, we have virtual retina displays, and small handheld portable devices could also be there. So this virtual retina display, if you want, it is quite costly, and there are very few manufacturers which are providing this. In India, we do not have such dedicated devices. Maybe we can import it from United States or from China or from Japan. These three countries are more into this devices manufacturing. But other than that, we can just have a handheld device and get it through this display. And there are also some special projectors, digital projectors, which have come up in the market, wherein we can just do the artifacts in the softwares and display that in 3D. So even now we have 3D display monitors and projectors which are also there that could be used. So this is just an overview of the different, what is ARVR, what are the devices which we have currently, what is the impact of this in different domains in VR and AR. Such a big concept, this is as part of the presentation which I had, around there is like 300 slides, but here I have compressed it and put it out. If you have any questions, you can ask me now.
Sorry, man. Informative session for today, and we all basically got the very massive and very important information regarding the AR and VR. So thank you, sir, very much from the Paro University side event.
Thank you so much.
Welcome, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.